Okay, so how do we figure this out?
Cleverly. So, when I see things like this, I just like to be methodical. So, why don't we just be methodical? So, I'm going to ask the question whether the VC dimension is at least one, because that's pretty easy to think about, and maybe I'll get a feel for how to get the right answer that way. Okay, so is the VC dimension at least one? Well, the answer is pretty clearly yes. So, if you just put a dot on the number line somewhere, you could, yeah, like that. You could label it positive just by picking any a less than or equal to that point and any b greater than or equal to that point. So if I were like drawing parentheses or something to indicate the interval, I could just put parentheses around the point and that would give me a plus. Or brackets. That would be fine. Okay, so that's pretty easy. And if I wanted it to be negative, I could just put both of the brackets on either side of the point. It doesn't matter. Let's say to the left. All right. That makes sense, Michael?
That's exactly what I was thinking about. Yeah, though I would have put the brackets on the right.
Yeah, you would. Okay, so then we could do the same argument for see if the VC dimension is greater than or equal to 2. So if I put 2 points on a line, so there are 4 possibilities. I've got to get plus plus, minus plus, plus minus, and minus minus. Okay, so we got to get plus plus, plus minus, minus plus, and minus minus. So the first and the last one are really easy. Actually, they're all easy. You can definitely do this. So if you want to get plus plus, you just need to put the brackets so that they surround the 2 points. That's good. If you want to get plus minus, you put the left bracket in the same place, and you put the right bracket just to the right of the point. Yeah. And you do the same thing for minus plus. And then for minus minus, you put the brackets on either side of both of the points. And so since you like it to the right, I'm going to put them to the left.
Good.
And there you go. That was pretty easy, I think. Okay, so next we need to figure out whether the VC dimension is at least 3. So we need 3 dots on a line, 3 distinct dots on a line. And we've got 8 possibilities. But Michael, I don't want you to write down those 8 possibilities because I think I see an easy way to answer the question right away.
Excellent.
So this is a lot like the last example we did with the theta. Except now we have
Yeah.
2 parameters. And the problem we have with the theta is that as we moved the theta over from left to right, we lost the ability to have a positive followed by a negative. So I think there's a similar thing here. So if you label those 3 points this way, plus, minus, and plus, I don't think you can do that. And that's because in order to get point 1 and point 3 in the interval, you're going to have to put the brackets on both sides of them. So you're going to have to put a left bracket to the left of the first point and a right bracket to the right of the third point. And that's the only way to make those two plus, but then you're always going to capture the one in the middle. So you can't actually shatter 3 points with this hypothesis class.
Now, you have to argue, though, that there isn't some other way you could arrange the 3 points. I don't know, like, I don't know, stacking them on top of each other or something.
You mean vertically on top of one of each other?
Yeah.
Well, then they wouldn't be an R, they'd be an R2.
Well, no, just like right on top of each other
Well, then
in
they're all
that.
the same point.
And you can't label them. Again, you have the same problem that you can't label one of them negative and the other one's positive. They're all on top of each other. So
Right.
there just isn't any way to set up these 3 points so that you're able to assign them all possible labels.
Right.
So good. So that gives us 2 as our answer here.
So, by the way, I think that's you said something I think that's really important. In order to prove the lower bound, in order to prove 1 and 2, all we had to do was come up with an example where we could shatter, right?
Yes, that's exactly right.
Right. So that's good, and that's really nice because otherwise we're in a heap of trouble if we have to show that you can shatter every single thing. We just have to show that you can shatter one thing, so it exists. So that whole VC dimension is really a there exists some set of points you could shatter, not you can shatter everything.
That's right. And what would be an example of points that you couldn't shatter? Yeah, to a pair of points that you couldn't shatter.
Well, the ones on top of one another.
Yeah, exactly, because you wouldn't be able to assign them different labels. So
Right.
that would be a really bad choice, and here all we need is a good choice.
Right. So if you make good choices, you can shatter things, which sounds more violent than I intended. Okay, but in the third case with the VC dimension, it wasn't enough to show an example that you couldn't shatter because then you could do the same thing as you point out with the VC dimension of 2. Instead, you have to prove that no example exists. So there does not exist or a for all not or something like that.
For all, not.
Exactly. So that's an interesting set of requirements there, right? So proving a lower bound seems easier than proving an upper bound.
Though it's interesting because in this case, in cases one and two, you had to show that all the different combinations were covered, whereas in this last case, we just had to give one combination that couldn't possibly be covered.
Yeah, but it couldn't possibly be covered no matter what we did.
No matter what the input arrangement was.
Right.
Yeah.
Whereas in the first case, I had to show all possibilities, all possible labelings, but only for one example of orderings or one collection of points.
So just messily doing some bad predicate calculus to nail down what you're saying, that when we say that the answer is yes, we're saying that there exists a set of points of a certain size such that for all labelings, no matter how we want to label it, there is some hypothesis that works for that labeling. But to say no, we have to do the negation of that, which is not exist for all exists, which by standard logic rules says that means that for all points, no matter how you arrange the points, it's not the case that for all labels there exists a hypothesis, which again, De Morgan's law is not against De Morgan's law to apply this idea that says that's the same as for all arrangements of points, there's some labeling where there's no hypothesis that's going to work. And that's exactly how you made your argument.
Huh, except I didn't use De Morgan's law and upside down A's and backwards E's.
Oh, you did. Oh, you did.
I am the Morgan powerful.